It'd be pretty great to be able to tell what someone is thinking, to be able to read their minds. You could use your powers for good, you could use them for evil, or you could just get really good at card tricks. But there are many times every day, in all countries around the world, where doctors are desperate to try to read the mind of someone in front of them who has had a severe brain injury that's left them entirely unable to communicate. So maybe let's think about that more selfless reason to be able to read people's minds. How can we read minds? Well, if we're going to read minds, we need to know where to look first. Where is the mind? Well, the brain is a pretty good place to start. That's where all of your thinking happens. That's where you are. But the brain is staggeringly complicated. Each of these flashes are brain cells, neurons, sending signals to each other. As you can see, there's a lot going on. However, this is a video of neurons firing in a larval zebrafish. So that's a zebrafish, a type of fish that's only recently hatched, and their brain is less than 1 millimeter across. The human brain is a lot bigger than that. It has around 80 billion neurons. That's 80 followed by 9 zeros, and 800,000 times more neurons than this zebrafish. And each one of those neurons is connected to about 10,000 others. It's the most complicated structure in the universe, and we all have one inside our skulls. So how are we possibly ever going to read anything from something so complicated? Well, maybe let's aim for something a bit easier first. Like a magician narrowing down the possible cards you could be thinking of, what if we narrow down the possible things that people could be thinking about? What if we first ask people to think of, say, just one of two possible things, and see if we can work out which of the two they're thinking of? It'd be a start. But first, we need to measure the brain activity of the person whose mind we want to read. These zebrafish were genetically engineered so that their neurons actually glow when they fire, so then it's easier to see what's happening under a microscope. Now, we probably don't want to be genetically engineering humans so that their brains glow just yet, but we can get a pretty good look at what people's neurons are doing with a much less invasive method. This fashionable piece of headwear is called an EEG cap. EEG stands for electroencephalography, which literally means a recording of electricity from the brain. So when your neurons fire, they produce tiny electrical currents. But because you have so many neurons, when lots of them fire at the same time, the sum of their electrical currents is big enough to be detected from the surface of your head. So now we can measure their brain, we're a step closer to reading their mind. Now, what do we ask people to think about? We need two possible thoughts from which we can read the specific one that they're thinking of right now. It turns out that asking people to imagine that they're moving works pretty well. We know that the parts of the brain that are responsible for physically moving are very similar to those that are responsible for imagining moving. Here's some processed EEG data from a healthy person who's imagining moving their limbs. And you can see it's quite a nice clear pattern of brain activity over the parts of the brain that control movement. And we can use this pattern to accurately work out whether this healthy person is imagining moving their hands or their toes, for example. And we can be pretty accurate with this, to the point that healthy individuals can use these patterns of brain activity to even control video games. So now we can read their mind, or at least we can work out which of two things they're thinking about, without them telling us, which is a significant step. So how are we going to use our newfound power to read minds for good? Well, we can use this ability to help understand people who've had severe brain injuries. Some people, after a severe brain injury, will open their eyes and start to show some reflex responses to their environment, like startling at a loud sound, but they don't show any evidence that they understand what is being said to them, or that they have any thoughts whatsoever. These people, with what we call disorders of consciousness, are a big challenge for clinical care, because if we don't know if the person in front of us is conscious or not, then we don't know what sorts of medical decisions are in their best interests, or what their chances are of ever being able to communicate again. So how about we ask people with disorders of consciousness to imagine moving their hands and their toes, and then see if we can read their minds and detect that they're following our instructions? Well, it turns out that an estimated 15% of these patients produce appropriate patterns of brain activity in this sort of task. That is, they think about what we ask them to think about, and then we can correctly detect that they are doing it. In this image here, you can see the pattern of activity is remarkably similar between a control participant and the patient. So to emphasize this more, these are people who show no evidence from their behavior that they are conscious. And yet if we read their minds, we can see that some have been misdiagnosed. They're actually conscious. They're just only able to show it with our mind-reading technology. Now, it's important to say here that this is only a minority of patients with disorders of consciousness. The majority of patients who are chronically unresponsive after a severe brain injury are indeed unconscious, and many will have a very low likelihood of making any sort of meaningful recovery, if at all. These are difficult scenarios faced by many people every day in hospitals around the world, and difficult decisions are regularly made about whether it's in their best interests to continue treatment or to allow them to die. But this research shows that by reading the thoughts of patients after severe brain injuries, we can find valuable information to help families make these very difficult decisions. In fact, in some recent work, we found that those patients whose brain activity looks most like they're understanding what is said to them, even if their physical behavior doesn't show that, those patients are more likely to make a good recovery over the following 6 months. So this information can help us decide how best to treat these individuals. So learning how to read minds, to know if and what someone is thinking, can have a very real impact on patients, on their families, and their medical teams all around the world. Something else that's becoming clearer as we study the brain and the mind more is that thoughts and experiences are strongly linked not only to the brain, but also to the way that the brain and the body interact. You can understand this yourself on a fundamental level when you watch a horror film, or when you listen to your favorite song, or when you have to speak in front of your peers. These experiences are accompanied by sensations from your body. Your thought might be associated with feeling a bit sick, or with your heart racing, or feeling a bit dizzy. Now, this comes from your brain sending signals to your body about your current thoughts and changing what your body is doing so that it's prepared for what might come next. So, for example, increasing the level of adrenaline that's in your blood. And in turn, your body sends signals back to your brain about what those chemical changes are doing to your body. So then the brain can adjust what it's telling the body to do. And then this loop keeps going on and on so that your thoughts, your mind, essentially is no longer limited to your brain anymore, but is found in the interaction between your brain and your body. So this means that we can actually read people's minds without even looking at their brain. We can look at what their body is doing instead. For example, how fast their heart is beating. And we know that just from measuring the subtle ways in which a person's heart rate changes over time, we can work out, for example, whether that person is paying attention to what's being said to them. It's a basic level of mind reading so far, sure, but one with potentially significant impact, as we've already seen with unresponsive patients. So the question we asked at the beginning was, how to read minds? Well, first, you need a mind to read. For someone to have a mind to read, they need to have a brain, and probably specifically a brain inside a body. Second, you need a way to measure what's happening in the brain and the body. You could use EEG, as we discussed earlier, or any range of ways of quantifying signals from within the brain and the body. And finally, you need to start small. We're a long way from accurately knowing any possible thing that anyone is thinking of in front of us, unfortunately. But we can definitely use methods from psychology and from neuroscience to narrow it down to a couple of options. And in many cases, this is enough to make sure that we're delivering the most appropriate care to people who are recovering from severe brain injuries, who can't communicate with us, and so need us to read their minds.